So, welcome to everyone. Thank you, David, for being here. So, we're going
Yeah.
to discuss about the US election.
Yeah, we're having one, by the way. Yeah,
Yes,
soon. I don't know.
in a few
Yeah.
days. We thought it would be interesting to discuss with you and to share your views because you're a well-known American in Paris for the last 10 years at La Financière de l'Échiquier, but you're also a real specialist of what's going on that election front. You're very much involved. I don't know whether you want to speak about that, but we thought it would be interesting to have your own views and to share your knowledge about what's happening. The first question would be about the election process. I think, can you clarify a little bit what you think one should know about it?
Yeah, well, Pierre, it's very different in America compared to what it is in France. Just even the voting process is very different. We on our ballots, we will have 31 different things to vote for. So everybody always says to me, "Why does it take so long to count?" Well, because we got 31 different races. For example, in North Carolina, where I vote, I'm voting for not just president. Everybody in America is going to be voting for the House of Representatives because you vote for that every 2 years. Some places will have a U.S. Senator to vote for. I've got a governor to vote for, a lieutenant governor, Secretary of Agriculture, an insurance commissioner, school board races. So it takes a long time to count all of these on election day. So that's why. My favorite story, the first year that my wife and I were here
I
in
remember.
France, election day, and we were all excited, and my wife made popcorn, and we got the soda and beer out. We're going to stay up all night and watch the results. 8 o'clock, polls close. 8:01, they announce the winner, and it's over. It's like, what happened? In the U.S., it's going to take a much longer process. And in fact, in North Carolina, where I vote, not only do we have these 31 races on the ballot, but throughout the state, there are 2,300 different types of ballots because of all the different permutations of different things you can be voting for. So, again, it's a long process. There are 50 states. And that's the other thing that you have to understand. This is not a national election, this is an election in 50 states. And you need to get to 270 electoral votes. And you're going to say, what are electoral votes and how do we get those? Basically, every state is given an electoral vote for each of its representatives and each of its senators. And in the US, there are 435 representatives across the country. And
Depending of population, more or
depending on
less.
population, every 10 years we have a census to determine the population. And it works out right now about every 750,000 people get a
More or less, more
representative. Although it is guaranteed that every state gets at least one representative. So, for example, California has 39 million people, it gets 52 representatives. A state like Wyoming has less than 600,000 people, but it still gets a representative. And then on top of that, each state, no matter how big or how small, gets two senators. So Wyoming with 600,000 people gets two senators. California with 39 million people gets two senators. So when you add up your representatives and your senators, California ends up with 54 electoral votes. And that means each person or each electoral vote represents about 720,000 people. If you go to Wyoming, which gets three electoral votes for its 600,000 people, it's 200,000 people for each electoral vote. So there's a built-in bias towards small rural states, and that gives Republicans who tend to be favored in those kinds of environments an electoral college bias. So that's how we get to the results of like 2016 or even the year 2000, where the winner of the national election, who gets the most votes, does not become president because they haven't picked up enough electoral
Yeah,
votes.
but the discrepancy was what, 2.9 million between Clinton and
Yeah, at least a 3 million
Trump,
vote
yes.
difference. And Yeah, and again, that's because the Democrats typically will run up the vote in their states, but it doesn't benefit you. Once you get above one more than you need, it's all kind of wasted votes.
Well, seen from France, it's a little bit special system, but it's the way the largest democracy in the world, apart India, does work.
Yeah, well, and again, it comes because of our historical background. The states were created before the country. So to get the states to come together to create the country, they all had to compromise and give up something. And for the small states to agree, they had to get their share of the pie.
So the result of all this organization is leading to what is called swing states. Can you elaborate on swing states? Because, please.
Yeah, well, out of the 50 states, basically, 43 of them, we already know how they're going to vote.
No surprise.
Right. They're all very lopsided, one-sided. And so there are basically seven states now that are in play that everybody's fighting for that will decide the election. And those states are, we have what we call the blue wall or the Rust Belt states. These are formerly industrial states, did a lot of manufacturing. And deglobalization or globalization has really hurt them over the years. And those are Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania.
The blue state, why? Blue wall? Because they used to be Democrats?
They used to be solid Democrats, and the Democrats could always count on them.
Okay.
And that was the big surprise when Trump won, is that he flipped all three of those for the first time ever. And, and again, much of the reason because of the decline of urban centers in those cities. Detroit is the largest city in Michigan. If you go back to the 1950s, it was the third largest city in America with about 2 million people. Today, I think it's around 400,000 people. So as the city has become much smaller and the urban has become much less important to the state, it has become more rural and more Republican, more competitive. And then we have four, they call them the Sun Belt states, Nevada and Arizona out west, and Georgia and North Carolina on the east coast. They're also very competitive and usually within 1%. And that's going to decide the election.
Yeah, because what's the, as far as we can read everywhere, you know, there is no one knows what's going to get out of this election. So Harris seemed to be away, you know, 15 days ago, or 3 weeks ago. Now it looks more even. So what should we expect of these swing states, basically? No one knows?
That's the best answer I've heard. No one knows what's going to happen. Nobody really trusts the polls. Even the pollsters don't anymore.
Yeah, they've been wrong every time, more or less in the past. No?
They've been wrong, and they've been trying to capture things that are very hard to capture. It used to be very predictable because you could call people on their telephone, their landlines, and you would get somebody at home, and you knew what you get. Now in the age of cell phones and caller ID, you don't know who's answering and if it's representative. And the other thing that has messed up the polling is that we have seen an enormous increase in participation in the U.S. And we used to have, we call them low propensity voters. People who really never showed up to vote. That changed in 2016. Donald Trump got them to come out to vote. And they voted in much larger numbers than anybody expected for him. And that has made polling much less predictable because you can't just say likely voters because you don't know who is likely to vote.
So if my question is, what is the current dynamic right now? What would be your answer?
Nobody knows.
Nobody knows.
I think it's fair to say that today, which is 1 week before the election, we're 7 days out, it really is a case of the polls have tightened. And there's been, we went through a stage where Harris looked like she had momentum and was moving ahead. And then they've really tightened up. And now it looks like Trump has momentum. And a lot of people have asked me, well, what happened? What caused this change in momentum? And there were really two things that happened. One is that Harris did well whenever she had big events. And people got to see her and they liked her and she would get a boost. So in August, they had the Democratic convention. She came off very well, got a boost out of that. And then they had the debate, the one where Trump was talking about eating cats and dogs. That gave her a boost again at that point. But then Trump very wisely said, no more debates, no more events. So she didn't have anything else that was able to give her that boost. And then the most predictable thing in American politics is negative advertising. We will have spent about $2 billion on this election. And the last billion has been complete negative advertising.
What do you call negative advertising? Sorry.
You're just bashing your opponent.
Bashing your opponent.
An example of one, and I like to watch American football on Sundays. And those all through those games, every other commercial was a Trump commercial attacking Harris for promoting transgender surgeries for prisoners. Apparently, it happened once in California while she was Attorney General. I don't know the whole story, but you would think that this is a major issue in America that we have all these prisoners getting constant transgender surgeries. But again, it was just designed to knock her down. And she's done the same thing to him too. So it goes both ways. But the difference being everybody knows Donald Trump. They've known him for years. All his negatives are out there. So you can't get him more negative, whereas she wasn't known. So negative advertising was very effective.
That's an interesting point. If we go to the program side, what would you say are the key differences between the two programs? What would you highlight? Because Trump is promising a lot of things.
The main difference, especially for investors, is the issue of tariffs. And Trump has said he wants huge tariffs on everybody. There's no distinction between friend or enemy. In the world of economics, for Trump, everybody's an enemy.
Custom taxes.
Yes.
When you import goods to the U.S.,
you're going to have a tax. There's going to be a tax put on those goods. Now, it's actually paid by the U.S. person.
Consumer, yes.
Yeah, the person importing it, or if they can pass it on to the consumer, fine. It's not like China writes a check with everything they send over. Whereas for Harris administration, tariffs, they would keep tariffs like Biden did, but it's more for national defense purposes and protecting things that are needed for national security, such as on semiconductors and promoting internal production for those types of goods. They like to talk about a small garden with high walls. For Trump, it's just high walls everywhere. And I think that has very big implications for Europe and the European economy because there is no distinction in a Trump administration. It is Europeans have been taking American jobs. We've been suckers for letting them do it. So we're going to hit them with tariffs, at least 10% on everything. And at the same time, the world is being broken into two, US-led or China-led, and Europe is going to get caught in between. And I think it's very bad news for Europe from that standpoint.
Yeah, that's an interesting message. Company taxes also, do you believe in that? Because apparently Harris wants to hike them, Trump wants to lower them. What do you think of these?
Well, at this point, as we've gone through, every week Trump has given somebody a tax break. And he's now actually at the point where he's talking about tariffs high enough to eliminate all income taxes on Americans.
I've heard that.
Yeah, well, it's impossible. But
is it realist?
No, you can't import enough to make up that kind of money. But we knew we were getting to this point because he was going to tax-free tips, tax-free overtime, lower taxes on corporations. I mean, he ran out of things that he could lower taxes, so it's just like, eh, nobody pays any taxes. So, again, that's unrealistic. We know it's unrealistic. But there's definitely a concern that Trump will be much more, create much bigger budget deficits because he doesn't really care about the budget. He's very happy to keep lowering taxes, whereas there's much more fiscal restraint from the Harris side. So it would be reasonable to expect higher taxes, especially on the corporate side, at the higher income levels, to raise some taxes if Harris were to come in.
That's the main topic for the people that are voting, the economy, or is it immigration? Because
it's immigration.
It's immigration.
Immigration is the major. There are two issues, immigration and abortion.
And abortion.
Abortion for Harris, immigration for Trump. And, you know, the economy has gotten better since last spring. And so its importance among Americans has declined. And of course, we're starting to realize that we do have the best economy in the world. You know, it doesn't feel like it to most Americans. But for those of us living outside, we know it. It was on the cover of The Economist magazine this week. So that has kind of receded, and those kind of concerns have fallen down. And both campaigns are just focused on their main issue, which is immigration and abortion.
And would you say, you know, you mentioned the program that Trump wants to put in place. Can he do it, or does he need to pass it through, you know, the Congress, basically?
Basically, when it comes to tariffs, the president is allowed to do whatever he wants.
So he could put a big plan without any authorization from the Congress.
Right. Yeah, a long time ago, Congress gave up its rights to the president on things, issues like tariffs. So the president does not need to go back to Congress and get approval for it. So when he says he's going to do this on day one, he can do it on day one.
So we should be careful about that.
You should believe that's actually going to happen.
Okay. And would you say Trump would be more inflationist than Harris for the U.S.? Because, you know, there is this situation also that inflation has receded, but, you know, it's still around between 2 and 3% in the U.S., you know. Where should we expect to see it with Trump and with Harris, in your point of view?
Yeah, you know, again, inflation issues were a global issue, and they've receded globally. I think that if you look at the whole program of higher tariffs across the board, the other issue is what happens to the labor market. You know, he's talking about mass deportation of 13 million illegal immigrants.
Which is inflationary too.
Right. You would all of a sudden have much fewer workers, which would cause wages to go up, higher deficits. It all points to a more inflationary regime under a Trump than a Harris administration. Then there's the issue of who runs the Federal Reserve. Jay Powell's term comes to an end in 2026, and Trump has made it known that he does not want a Jay Powell-like person. He's much in favor of lower interest rates across the board. How independent will the Fed be is also another question that investors have got to figure out.
There is a lot of contradiction.
Yes.
to say. You see any obvious trade that, you know, would be if Harris is elected or if Trump is elected, what would you do, you know? How is it going to affect, you know, your investment strategy to speak about? Because I do remind everyone that you're running World Equity Growth with a team, obviously, but you're in charge of strategy. So what would be the implication from a point of view?
Yeah, and obviously we've seen some of this play out as markets start to price in a higher probability of a Trump win.
Do you agree that the market is already pricing Trump?
Yes, you can definitely see the market pricing not only Trump, but a, quote, red wave, meaning the Republicans get control of the Senate, which is almost a guarantee at this point, as well as maintain control of the House of Representatives, which would basically give an unfettered, unrestrained agenda for Trump. And you can see that the most obvious play is in Bitcoin. Bitcoin has been skyrocketing over the last month.
I've seen that. Why so?
Because Trump came out very much in favor of cryptocurrencies during the summer. So he's become very identified with that trade. You know, other obvious plays with Trump, banks. Mm-hmm. He's going to be much more
less
deregulatory,
regulation.
Much less regulation. Mm-hmm. Other areas, you know, probably on the pharmaceutical side, pricing wise, much less aggressive. I'm pushing back on the pharmacies, much less aggressive on the health insurers, and probably good for big tech, much less anti, much less focus on being anti-monopoly and letting winners win, especially as it pertains to competition against China. He likes having companies that can compete against the Chinese giants, so he's much more likely to not break up Google. He will probably keep TikTok around just as a negotiating thing with China. So I think those are some of the key differences. But again, I think it's also bad for Europe. The dollar will be stronger under a Trump administration, for sure, just because of the tariffs. And so the euro will be getting weaker. You'll be able to export less to America. It's not a good combination at all.
No, that's not a good scenario. Yeah. And so, if it's Harris, what would be, it's going to be the contrary? Not so much, actually, because apparently she will keep anti-Chinese also policy, no, like Biden has done, or less probably, but...
Yeah, she will be much more status quo with China. The tariffs that are in place will stay in place. The export controls on semiconductors and things, because China has clearly identified itself as a competitor to the U.S. But there will be more willingness to cooperate with China. Of course, the biggest change, and I did not mention this, between Trump and Harris will be on the environmental side. You know, the Green New Deal will stay in place under Harris. Trump, on day one, will again remove the U.S. from the Paris climate controls, will not support any green energy, and that would be very bad for any company in those sectors.
So there is very low visibility right now until the election day, and you know, it's not even the election day that it will bring us visibility, you know, what do you think?
Yeah, it is likely to take several days. And some of that is just the institutional nature of how the U.S. counts ballots. For example, states like North Carolina and Georgia, two of the battleground states, have large military populations. And in the U.S., I think in North Carolina, the military has a week to get their ballots sent back. You know, that again is unusual, I think, compared to France. In the U.S., we're allowed to mail in your ballot. You don't have to show up in person. So you can request a mail-in ballot. And in the military, because if you're on an aircraft carrier in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, it can take a while for your ballot to get back. So they won't even have all the ballots for a week for them to count. So if it's close, you've got to wait for everything to come in before you can declare a winner. And in Pennsylvania, they can't start counting any of the mail-in ballots until Election Day. And that means opening them up, seeing who it is, checking them on the register to see it's valid, then opening it up and counting it. So Pennsylvania, last time, it took them until Saturday after the election to have them all counted. I think North Carolina and Georgia took them both a week after the election.
So it's likely that we won't get any clear result until the end of the next week, I would say.
Correct.
So what's going to happen on the market in the meantime? What do you think?
Oh, there'll be a lot of volatility. There'll be a lot of whispers. Mm-hmm. You know, people say, oh, it looks like Trump's winning and his stocks will go up. Then they'll say, oh, no, now it looks like it's Harris. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the rumors will drive things. Mm-hmm. I think from an investor standpoint, you just wait until you know something. Mm-hmm. Until you know something, you don't know anything. And that's the approach that I'm taking in the fund is until I know something, just leave everything alone and go with your best estimate. Mm. I do think that right now, and again, we're a week before the election, the markets have gotten a little bit too far ahead of themselves in this Trump victory scheme, and they've kind of rallied too far, indicating a probability that I don't think is there. Mm. I think it's still a 50-50. Mm-hmm. Now, he might win, but he might not. And I think markets have priced in a very high probability of a win at this point.
That's an interesting point. For our friends that are listening to us and that are going to watch the electoral night, I know that you've got an advice. They should look at one state from your point of view. Can you explain?
Yeah, the easiest state to watch, and what I'm watching, is Virginia.
Virginia.
It's an interesting state because there's no major urban center in the state. The largest city, I think it's Richmond or maybe it's Norfolk, but it's right next door. The northern part of the state is right next door to Washington, D.C. So a lot of government employees commute every day into work. And its polls close early at 7 o'clock Eastern time. And it generally is a Democratic state, but it has a very large rural population. So there's a strong Republican contingent. In 2016, when Trump won the election, they did not call the state for Hillary Clinton until 10:30 at night, three and a half hours after the polls closed. That was an indication that it's going to be a much closer race than what people had thought. In 2020, they had called it for Joe Biden within 30 minutes of the polls closing. So that's what I'm going to be watching for election night, which would be, you know, 1:30 a.m. Paris
1:30
time.
1:30 a.m.
Yes.
That's okay.
Yeah. If they're calling Virginia for Biden, then you know things are going according to plan. Mm-hmm. If it's much later than that, if it's more like 3:30, 4:30 in the morning, then you know the Republican is much stronger than what the polls
are
picking up.
That's a good point. So I'm going to follow your advice. And thank you for all these explanations.
Yes.
That was very helpful. I think it's you gave us a lot of answers. And again, if you ready to do it, I propose that we do another round table or meeting like that after the elections, you know, when we'll know a little bit more about the results.
That sounds good to me. I can tell you that, you know, right now there are teams of lawyers. This thing's going to be litigated. So what we think we know, even when we know it, we still might not know it.
No. Thank you, David.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.